Holy smokes, welcome to an amazing day for Tesla. Congratulations to all Tesla investors. This is so exciting. Where is this button when you need it?
Nice, PP.
Yes, exactly. Ah, the pricing power at Tesla is coming through, especially something that not a lot of folks are paying attention to. This line right here, 9.4 gigawatts on energy products. Folks, that's more than double. It's 2.3x what we saw in the last Q1 gigawatts deployed of energy. I mentioned over here that if we have the same gross profit margin as we did in Q1, we should be seeing an additional $935 million to Tesla's bottom line, because the energy storage business is profitable. It's got good margins. This is going to help with some of those negative cash flow concerns. Just like, you know, the financing that Tesla introduced in Q2 to really try to solidify a vehicle deliveries bottom, I personally think they'll probably amortize the costs of that discounted financing over time. That might sound really complicated, so I'm going to translate that to English. Margin could be really good in Q2. Okay, so I'm actually pretty optimistic here. These were the deliveries. We're down 4.76% on deliveries, 14.3% on vehicles produced. So we reduced some vehicle production, probably shifted some of that to battery deployment, and really made some dollar hollas. Now, this is great. Q2, fantastic. Really trying to solidify a bottom here in the same quarter that Elon was fighting for his compensation plan. This makes a lot of sense. How sustainable this is going to be remains to be seen. This is not me being bearish. This is just me being reasonable to argue that there is a potential that some of the tricks that were deployed in Q2 to pump these delivery figures right here, specifically some of those interest rate offers, are now no longer available at all, which makes me think that there was a little bit of a desire to really solidify a bottom right before the robotaxi event and at the same time of Elon's compensation plan vote. Again, this is not me trying to be jaded. It's just, look, 6.29 is the lowest rate I could get on a Model Y right now. After they did 0.99 on the Y, they went to 1.9, and even that's gone now, which is kind of wild. I thought they would have kept doing this if it was so successful, but I'm starting to think, but the idea wasn't to always have this. The idea, see, even 6.29 on all the threes, the idea was to just do this at the time it mattered most. Now, this is not me trying to be a Tesla bear. It's just trying to set expectations that, yes, this is a great way to try to set a bottom for Tesla. Yes, I've been calling for Tesla to hit 221 and break above it, frankly, since like April and May, and then the beginning of June, we're like, oh my gosh, volatility is so low, volatility is going to explode, and when it does, the stock is going to explode, and that's literally exactly what's happening right now. At the time of this recording, the stock is up over 9%, had some call options this morning, print some tendies, which is delicious. As always, I send those alerts to everyone in my stocks and site group when I see a trade, or I see a swing trade, or I see something that could be an opportunity, which is great. But what we have to also consider is there is a risk to macro. And so this is nothing to do with Tesla, because Tesla specifically, I think the bottom's in on Tesla. I don't actually believe we're going to go below 200. And if we do go below 200 again, I think it'll be a gift. However, there are some warning signs. For example, the Goldman Sachs bull/bear market indicator. This is a chart that goes all the way back to 1955. And this chart, because it goes all the way back to 1955, it's not so horribly precise, but it does show us up here at a peak level. But then again, it also, if you look very, very closely, shows us off of that peak level a little bit already. But what's fascinating is if you consider what's already off peak level a little bit, we think of Nvidia being off peak level a little bit. We think of the Qs, yes, kind of green right now after J Powell's done yapping his trap, which is to be expected. But it makes you wonder, are we hitting a ceiling here? At the same time, we're getting a steepening of the yield curve. We look at those two tens. The spread between those is suggesting we could be in for a period of somewhat softness, or potentially some fear going into the pretty classic catalyst of an election. Usually in the months before an election, you do end up having a sell down, which could be an opportunity to buy the dip. If you feel like you're missing out and you're FOMOing a little bit, there might be other opportunities to buy. I don't know that the market is going to continue to go straight up from here, but hey, anything is possible. So let's consider the following. First, we do have the 210 continuing. Yesterday, we caught up on how the 210's falling, or rather the 210 spread steepening. So the yield rising is often indicative of either a flat market, if we get the steepening for a week to 2 weeks, we're at day seven, or a market that falls if we get more than that. Right now, the 210 spread, which you can calculate on screen here, all you have to do on the right side of the screen is grab that 2-year treasury yield, which you can grab from CNBC. So we write down 4.727. We're gonna minus that from this 10-year, 4.446. Technically, I should be minusing the 10 from the 2, but whatever, I'm going to flip that to negative. We're about 28 basis points inverted right now. 28 basis points of inverted is, more uninverted than where we were yesterday. Again, a sign that, okay, markets could be giving us a reason for some pause, mostly because we haven't seen some pause. That is not a bearish thing. It's just saying, if you feel like you're missing out on Tesla, there could end up being another opportunity to get in. I personally think the opportunity to get in is much in line with what I said yesterday. I think between today and the earnings date, you could potentially try to price in some bad news, although it's also possible you just get a bunch of industry upgrades, although usually those don't come out until you actually get the earnings. You could get some industry upgrades, stock could go up more, absolutely. But I wouldn't be surprised to see some red days between now and earnings day, and then almost certainly am I expecting some red when it comes to the robotaxi event. So don't get me wrong, heavily exposed to Tesla. It's the largest position in a fund that I manage. It's not an advertisement for that fund. I'm very, very happy because now my performance gets boosted. Again, we're not comparing returns or trying to be relative here. We're just simply saying I'm bullish. I just do see that it's possible this Q2 spike could be a little bit of a one-time misnomer. And it's possible that after the 8-8 event, and once we start getting Q3 delivery numbers, which would be in about 3 months from now, so July is month 7, so about the beginning of October, we could start seeing, which would be right before the election, October could be a really big Tesla buy the dip opportunity. Now, is that because it ran up to 300 and then down to 270, or do we go back to 200? I have no idea. I'm just saying, I do believe there's not just a clean path forward here, though this is very, very exciting for Tesla. And I'm very excited to see what the margins are going to end up looking like for that energy business. That energy business is something a lot of people don't really pay attention to. And I think it's really worth paying attention to. Now, Morgan Stanley did throw out a note which we can take a peek at here. I see on X, first positive surprise of the year. Tesla started its Independence Day celebration early with a positive Q2 delivery beat, 33K lower inventory, and a large storage beat to remind investors it's not just an auto company. While this is one of the first and only positive auto surprises of the year, we still believe matching last year's delivery number would be difficult to achieve. We did also see an inventory reduction, which should increase our net working capital, and we saw the show stealer of the energy storage deployment. Now, there's a question. Is Tesla getting its mojo back? Elon's comp plan was approved. Fast forward, clients are beginning to ask us about positive results into Q2 and beyond. We're getting asked about Tesla Energy, the humanoid robot TAM. So a lot of really bullish things ahead for Tesla as well. So possibly the way to look at Tesla is if you feel a little bit of FOMO, you buy a little, knowing there are going to be dips again in the future. And I'm just trying to provide a balanced perspective here. But congratulations to anybody exposed to Tesla. This is great news. And folks, good job out there. Good luck. And we'll see you in the next one. We'll keep paying attention to volatility. We'll also keep paying attention to that inverted yield curve. Thanks so much. Goodbye.
Advertise these things that you told us here. I feel like nobody else knows about this.
We'll try a little advertising and see how it goes.
Congratulations, man. You have done so much. People love you. People look up to you.
Kevin Paffrath there, financial analyst and YouTuber. Meet Kevin. Always great to get your take.
Even though I'm a licensed financial advisor, licensed real estate broker, and becoming a stockbroker, this video is not personalized advice for you. It is not tax, legal, or otherwise personalized advice tailored to you. This video provides generalized perspective, information, and commentary. Any third-party content I show shall not be deemed endorsed by me. This video is not and shall never be deemed reasonably sufficient information for the purposes of evaluating a security or investment decision. Any links or promoted products are either paid affiliations or products or services we may benefit from. I also personally operate an actively managed ETF. I may personally hold or otherwise hold long or short positions in various securities, potentially including those mentioned in this video. However, I have no relationship to any issuer other than HouseHack, nor am I presently acting as a market maker. Make sure if you're considering investing in HouseHack to always read the PPM at househack.com.